thanks everyone for being here and for being a part of the conversation that has been going on the past couple days. It's been super rapid, like Greg said. So before I start with all of numbers and everything, I'm not from San Antonio. I don't live in San Antonio. So while I have numbers and everything in this presentation, I don't have the experience that a lot of y'all have. I've never stood at a bus stop in the West Side in 105 degree heat. I haven't watched my favorite shade tree die in the fifth year of the drought this past decade, or anything like that. So while the numbers will probably confirm all of your experiences, they're useful because you can't argue with numbers. I said to Greg earlier after we left the city council meeting that he could tell me that the Spurs are having their best season in 20 years, but the numbers would argue otherwise. So hopefully these numbers will help to ground us and compare to other places in Texas and let us know that it's very possible to have a different city. So, yeah, so this is the bombshell that we got a couple days ago. This graph especially was the first thing that was, I guess, leaked to us. What it shows is peak generation for CPS increasing steadily. You can see that it goes down once and then just goes up and up and up. So no effort apparently to engage in actual energy efficiency practices. And we have this flex gen bar getting bigger and bigger and being about added with the natural gas already. That makes for up to one-third of CPS's energy at peak from natural gas in 2042. And notice as well that while 100-watt light bulb uses more energy, if you have that 100-watt light bulb running for 2 hours, that is 200 watt hours. So that's what a watt hour is, or a kilowatt hour. It's just how much it's using times how long it's being used for. So to put those into perspective, an average household in San Antonio uses 1,000 kilowatt hours of energy each month. That's 1 million watt hours. So these are just kind of, it's not super important to know the details, but knowing the difference between a watt and a watt hour is important because that's the sort of thing that utility execs will sneer at people for not knowing, and it's not cool. Additionally, just knowing that a really big power plant, like Spruce 1 or Spruce 2, the coal plants, their capacity, so that would be the most that they could possibly use or create, would be between 500 and 1,000 megawatts. So does anyone have any questions for clarification on these terms? Cool. It's not super important to know them really, really deep, but just knowing the vocab is important. Okay? So CPS Energy is huge. It's the biggest municipal gas and electric utility in the country. This map is Bexar County. CPS firmly planted in the middle, servicing the majority of people in Bexar County. Their sales provide over 20% of the entire city's revenue stream. That's important to consider when you think about why the city manager loves CPS so much. It's because 20% of all the money that is allocated in the city comes from CPS, their profits. But CPS does not just supply power to San Antonio. It also supplies power to Floresville, Hondo, Castroville, Lampasas, Bandera, Bernie, Seguin, and Kerrville. Not, as Paul Goldwilliams said in our last meeting, Hondo and Lampasas and a couple other small ones. It provides a lot of power to other towns in Central Texas. And that's where a lot of this 20% of city revenue comes from. And so, just a bigger version of the map, just to point out that most of that energy is generated down at the Calaveras Lake Power facility. That's where the Spruce plants are, the Dealey plant is, And down here we have Brownig and Rosenberg.
Natural gas plants.
Coal, natural gas. Maybe coincidentally, definitely not, on the southeast side of the city. Next one. Yeah, and here's just some of the dates that these plants are from, just to kind of get a perspective on how old these things are. Dealey, which is shutting down at the end of the year, from 1977. We have spruce. Spruce 1 is from 1992. We're the same age. And spruce 2 is from 2008. The last coal plant built in Texas. So, good to know. And as well, the oldest units are actually from Brownig, 1966, these natural gas units. They are not modern. They are used to boil steam and power a turbine. That is different than a combined cycle plant, which is what new natural gas facilities are, big ones. So this is an old technology.
Why was this the last coal plant built in Texas?
I wasn't here for the fight, so I don't want to answer that question. But for all of y'all who are here for the fight over Spruce 2, does anyone have any input on that? Why it was?
We're looking at all the old people.
Yeah, I'm thinking just nationally. Coal tanked,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. So there was a period when coal seemed like a good idea. It was because natural gas prices spiked up huge, and then there was an idea to make more new coal plants, and then natural gas prices plummeted.
Yeah. Some of us might not remember, but when Bush first came in, Bush 2 first came in 2001. Dick Cheney had a big energy plan for the country to build like 1,000 coal plants. The Sierra Club immediately reacted to that and thought that was crazy, and fortunately was successful in preventing most of those from being built. It would have been catastrophic to our air quality, not to mention our greenhouse gas emissions, CO2 emissions. So.
Yeah, and CPS spent a lot of money on Spruce 2, that's for sure. And that's the biggest reason why in the draft that they have and what they presented today, why Spruce 2 is supposed to still be producing in 2042, because they dumped a lot of money into that plant in 2008. Okay, we can go to the next slide. So here's just some more information on CPS, showing how big it is, a little bit of a comparison. So over 700,000 residential customers of CPS in San Antonio and around San Antonio. They use 9,500 gigawatt hours of energy a year. That's only useful as a comparison to the commercial customers. 84,000 commercial customers, that's businesses, small production facilities, they use more, 11,500 gigawatt hours by commercial customers. 55 industrial customers, that's like the Toyota facility, is the largest one. 900 gigawatt hours, still very significant. And just as a comparison, so CPS produces 28,500 gigawatt hours of electricity annually. So that's useful as a comparison to Austin Energy, which is almost exactly half the size of the production at 14,000 gigawatt hours. So just kind of let you know, CPS, huge, massive, and they sell to those cities that I pointed out earlier, 5,500 gigawatt hours. So when Paul Goodwin says we sell a little bit to a couple cities, it's a lot. Yeah. So where does that energy come from? So for utilities, numbers are usually about 2 years behind because how they report to the federal government. So we only know in 2015 the exact numbers, but in 2015, at the end of 2015, CPS was producing from 29% coal, 27% gas, 30% nuclear, 13% wind, and 1.8% solar. There have not been any substantial utility scale renewables added since then. Austin Energy in 2015, which has since added significant utility scale renewables, was As far as renewables go, 23% wind, a little bit less solar, but now they have significantly more solar. And they actually, on their website, have a live ticker, Austin Energy does, for how much renewables are being used for the production. So I checked right before I started this presentation. Energy was by renewables, mostly solar. And it's even a better comparison to compare it to ERCOT, which is the Texas energy grid. So in 2015, CPS was a little better in renewables. No better in coal. And this past year, Texas as a whole actually had 17% wind on the grid. So celebrating a 20% renewable victory is actually just being average. So I don't know, I didn't get much of a congratulations, but I brought home a C when I was in school, so I don't know if we should celebrate that for CPS. Why does it matter? Because with every day that we have a coal plant in the city and natural gas plants, we're producing from those smokestacks greenhouse gas emissions. They account for, this is from the sustainability plan. This is the greenhouse gas inventory for San Antonio. 53% of all community greenhouse gas emissions are from the electricity sector. So the majority are from CPS. That's where we talk about thinking globally, because that's the climate altering gases. Then we get to our nitrous oxides that produce ozone. So San Antonio does not meet federal regulations for ozone. What does ozone do? Burns your lungs. It lets asthma flare. Who knows somebody with asthma in San Antonio? Exactly. That's not a coincidence. We don't meet federal guidelines in San Antonio. But that's a regional issue. Ozone flows with the wind. There are bad ozone days. When you walk outside, if you have asthma, you walk outside and it feels hard to breathe. Those are bad ozone days. But that's not the only thing that comes out of these plants. You also get particulate emissions. Those are more localized. They do similar things as ozone does. But there's also mercury, lead, and other heavy metals, especially from the coal plants. And those are localized because they're heavy. They linger from the sky and they stay at ground level. There's no safe level of lead or mercury in a person's bloodstream. That is especially true for children while they're developing. We all know that lead used to be in gasoline. There was a huge debate over that back in the day before I was alive, but there is no lead, there's no unleaded coal. So when you burn it, it goes into the sky and it stays on the southeast side of the city. Okay, we can go to the next one. So what are our goals in San Antonio for renewables? Well, the only goal that we have as a city is for 20% renewable by 2020 and 65% nothing changing. This isn't even assuming that electric vehicles will be a thing. This is just if nothing changes, then by 2026, there'll be 25% renewables on the Texas grid on average. And by 2031, 28%. Now, if there's some environmental mandate in the future, that would be a carbon tax, or I think this was actually for the Clean Power Plan if it were to go into place, that there would be by 2026, 31.8% renewables on the grid. By 2031, 37% renewables on the grid. So should CPS lead or should CPS be below average? Right now, I don't think that 20% is much of a goal to have. So we heard in the B Council or the B session today that San Antonio needs to start comparing itself to its peers. What are San Antonio's peers doing? Are they pigeonholing themselves into goals? Yes, they are. It's the seventh most populous city in America. So I'll save you reading all these. And I'll tell you that every single one of these cities has the same goal, and it's for 80% greenhouse gas reductions by 2050, is every single one of their goals. Some of them have interim goals. New York State has a goal, as the state, to get 50% of its power from renewables by 2030. California has a goal of having 50% of its renewables by 2030 as well, and 100% by 2045. And San Diego, which, similar to CPS, is a municipal utility, San Diego Gas and Electric, they have a goal of 100% by 2035 for renewables. And let's go back a slide, actually. So something that I hate hearing, I live in Austin, of course, but I hate when I'm in a meeting with CPS and they sneer and say, well, we're not Austin, of course, as if Austin is like their baby cousin. Well, Austin's the 11th largest city in America. It is San Antonio's peer, and it's 80 miles away, and it has actual goals. So that's important to remember and know. Okay, let's go one more. So what is CPS's structure as a utility? It's a municipal utility. Originally, it was City Public Service. I tried to figure out, so CPS, like in documentation, doesn't actually stand for anything anymore. It's just CPS as three letters. And I really tried to figure out when they stopped calling themselves City Public Service. I looked through San Antonio Express News archives. And as far as I can tell, they stopped calling themselves that in the late 90s. I don't know for sure. But yeah, they're officially not the City Public Service, but they are owned by the city. And they have a board of trustees. It's five members. They're appointed by themselves. One of them is the mayor. One of them is the mayor, and then there's four quadrants, and they appoint by themselves another trustee. So they're in the process of that right now. There's a vacancy on the board. They picked someone, and he didn't want it, I guess. I don't know what the deal was. Also important to know that there's no citizens to be heard at these meetings. You can sit and listen, but there's no section for community members to make their voices heard. In past meetings with CPS, they had told us about this Citizens Advisory Council to reach out to 15 members, 10 of them appointed by city council members, one from each district, and five of them are nominated and appointed by themselves again, this Citizens Advisory Council. On the website, it says that the CAC provides a channel for two-way communication between the community and the utility. They don't have public meetings. They don't even post agendas online. And when the few times we brought up the CAC as an issue with CPS, well, they brought their legal counsel to the meetings and deferred to her. So, by comparison, this is weird. That's not how municipal utilities work in Texas. So there are a lot of other municipal utilities. Not all of them are big. Some of them are big. Austin is the biggest one. Most other large municipal utilities in Texas have their city council as the board. Lubbock is the exception. But it's appointed by city council, at least in Lubbock. There's nine of them. So Austin, Denton, Garland, Bryan, College Station, Georgetown, all of them have their city council as the board. And I've been to city council meetings in Austin where they are the board of the utility. And they're hard. They're harsh. They come to the board with plans, and city council debates them. I was in Austin yesterday, of course, and we were talking about the plan the CPS is unveiling, in the process of unveiling. We were talking about how ridiculous it would be if Austin Energy brought that plan to the Austin City Council. Our mayor would roast them. So let's go to the next slide. I get into this. So in Austin, this is how generation planning is done. This is how generation planning is done in most of those municipal utilities. So this is a brief history. I wasn't a part of this process, but Caiba White was a part of this entire process. So in 2009, Austin City Council formed an advisory committee to to work with Austin Energy to develop a consensus plan for its generation. That led to a goal of reaching 35% renewable energy by 2020 and reducing overall peak demand by 800 megawatts by 2020 as well. These meetings were open to the public, they included public input, and there was a third-party representative to run potential scenarios. Kaiba, I'm talking about Austin's generation planning.
All right.
Yeah. So you can tell me if I'm wrong on any of this. And then in 2010, the City Council adopted the plan. So let's go to the next slide. So this gets updated. In 2014, City Council again named a task force to develop a 2025 update to the plan. The task force worked with Austin Energy and developed goals. So there were some tensions at points, they were resolved, but the important thing is that the end goal was they decided to end coal use by 2023, raise their demand reduction goal to 900 megawatts, and add a 30 megawatt storage goal and a 950 megawatt solar goal. And Austin Energy committed to meet a 55% goal for its energy use from renewables by 2025. So these are developed with stakeholders. Let's go to the next slide. And yeah, most recently, Austin Energy updated it. And that update was what we saw earlier with those renewables goals. So the details of this aren't super important, but the process is the important thing that it was. So this isn't, all the municipal utilities don't have backroom sort of plans. They plan, and the city council is the board. So you elect the board. In San Antonio, it is weird that the mayor is on the board and apparently doesn't feel very empowered to speak up. They're rubber stamps. So with this new announcement, Terry.
Well, just a quick question. What are the finances between Austin Energy and the council? Is there a similar mechanism of budget support from Austin Energy to City Council?
Yes, somewhere around, I think, 12%.
So they still have some interest in being profitable as a nonprofit.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah. So I wanted to leave everyone with these questions after this presentation about CPS in San Antonio. So why does the City Council lack direct oversight of CPS generation planning? These are open questions. Why have residents of San Antonio consistently been kept out of the decision-making process of the utility that they own? This is a municipal utility. The city owns it. Why are the people of San Antonio's south side expected to breathe neurotoxins and asthma-inducing pollutants from fossil fuel plants through at least 2042? Why is that an expectation? And how can CPS Energy possibly call itself a leader in clean energy and renewable power, given the numbers that we've seen in this presentation? And just to leave on a metaphor, one that I've liked recently is, so we as people have a propensity to think about issues as they come up. This is an issue. We got to fight it. And then a few years later, an issue again. We got to fight this issue. So you're walking along, let's say, and there's a tree. Then you're walking along, there's another tree. And there's another tree. At what point do you realize you're in a forest? If these issues keep happening, you're in a system that creates those issues.
Yep.
So
win the battle, lose the war.
Exactly. So there we go. That's the end of it. So those are some guiding questions for y'all. And this presentation will be made public for anybody to use or look at. And
where's it at?
I'll share it. I'll share it. And any of these numbers, I sourced a lot of them in the notes, the speaker notes in the presentation. So there are sources for them. But if you want different numbers, I can usually find all those or clarification. You can always reach out to me, and I'm good at finding numbers and stuff.
Yeah, that's one of the things when we talk about coalition work, It's something that, that Sierra Club is fortunate to have as a large kind of grass top organization. We've got folks like Drew on retainer to just run out and do some like badass research. You know, I don't have time to do all that. Fortunately, I can pull Drew in, and other folks here have other, you know, distinctions, right, and skills, and the way they, you know, use their time and their power. So that's something we want to bring to the coalition for sure. And I don't know if you guys want to follow up and are in just open conversation on this subject till we've got 20 minutes.
Drew, I'm sorry, I thought you called on me. Yes?
Yeah, you're okay, go for it.
Drew, I'm especially interested in checking on the kinds of appeals that Austin is making with regard to trying to attract new businesses there, attractive rates for energy, for example, or water, and in particular, what do you know about the kinds of new businesses that are being brought in, and are there certain expectations that Austin has for those new businesses in terms of their energy efficiency practices and so forth? Or do they make any effort to get the existing businesses to reduce their usage or to buy a certain amount of renewable energy?
So I'm going to have to defer to Kaiva on some of this stuff. She's more of an expert on Austin specifically.
Well, I mean, certainly there's building codes, mm-hmm. and so Austin did just adopt the 2015 building code with some local amendments,
right.
One of which was a solar-ready amendment, so new commercial buildings need to basically just leave space on their rooftop where solar could be put in and eventually install it. In terms of like green energy, there is the Green Choice program. They've kind of changed it around, so it's not as good a program as it used to be. It doesn't necessarily result in additional renewable energy purchases anymore. But it's there, and that's definitely a big deal for commercial customers coming in. The majority of that program is commercial customers because they want to be able to say that, you know, they're green, so they participate in the program. And it's a revenue stream for the utility.
Okay.
Unfortunately, that revenue doesn't necessarily have to go to renewable energy purchases
right.
anymore.
Right, right, right.
But
yeah.
So Terry, Nissa, and then Alex.
I just wanted to hold up a graph I picked up the other day from a conversation with Bill Barker, and it's about climate plans from a number of cities around the country, and goals of 2050 to, like Drew was saying, 80%, et cetera. And Austin's up here, Dallas is down here, and San Antonio's in the middle. So clearly not what Councilman Saldana was saying in terms of leading the pack. In fact, I don't really know, and we're trying to find out where this data came from, because of course we haven't made our climate plan yet, and so this really is probably, again, from what we've just seen today, we're probably down here in the lower half somewhere. We're certainly not leading the pack in terms of any climate planning. I'll post. That's San Antonio. It's the error to San Antonio. So I'll try to get this stuff up on our website eventually. But
Alice, you had it?
Oh, yeah, Alice?
Yes, I was wondering about the program we have here in San Antonio. It used to be called Wintricity, and now they're calling it, I don't know, Sustainable Tricity or something. But they're saying it's got solar in it and wind in it, and my question is to Kaiba or Drew about, could you talk a little bit more about y'all's renewable energy option? I mean, okay, little backstory. I came from Houston about 9 years ago, and there's several companies. I was most comfortable with a company called Green Mountain Energy, and they had a good option for 100% renewable energy, and it sounded like they could back it up. So I stayed with them, and when I moved here, I was going, I'm transferring my account to San Antonio. And they said, oh, we wish you could, but there is a municipally owned energy company And if you can ever pry them loose from the city and let other people come in, sure, you can transfer your account, but not going to happen. So every now and then I ask the environmentalists, well, how about it? Wouldn't the city earn money from multiple energy companies? And the answer I invariably get is, well, we wouldn't have the control over multiple companies that we do over our energy company. And I do not see real control. So
In Austin, as Kaiba pointed out earlier, there's a Green Choice program where it does cost more, but I paid, and I think it's like $5 more a month for me.
Yeah.
And it's for 100% renewable. It's the wind percentage. But also San Antonio does have the community solar programs. However, that's a different pricing system than most people are used to. Do you have any additions, Kaiba?
I guess I would just say, Green Mountain is, I guess, better than most of the options in the places where they're choice, but Green Mountain is relying on renewable energy credits, not on building their own. So it's actually not that great. Georgetown is doing something very different. They are actually contracting for wind and solar farms. So that resulted in the creation of new renewable energy production. Green Mountain is just buying what's called a renewable energy credit, and that is something that is separate from the electricity. It's supposed to represent the greenness of the electricity, and it was created when the state of Texas established a renewable portfolio standard, and so that was a requirement to have a certain amount of renewable energy in the market. But they didn't increase that requirement, and the market kept growing because the cost of wind and now solar got really cheap. So basically, there's a lot more renewable energy credits than there is requirement to have them. So the credits have very little value, and so they can be purchased for a very low cost, and they don't really drive new development. So anytime you hear that something is being greened up with a renewable energy credit or a REC, you can know that it's kind of greenwashing, at least in Texas. In other places where those standards keep ratcheting up, RECs do have value, they do drive the market, and they're meaningful.
Can you spell RECs?
REC.
Just an acronym, renewable energy credit.
And you raised a good point, Allison. It's one thing that I didn't point out in my presentation. For municipal utilities, as we know in San Antonio, you don't have a choice of who you buy from. If you haven't lived outside of San Antonio, you might not know that other places are competitive markets. So you lived in Houston, where you chose one. Kaiba pointed out that it was one that was green because of RECs. So a neat thing about San Antonio is that it's owned by the city and can be changed very big. So you can actually rely on governance by people to change the utility. You don't have to rely on market factors, which we all know are a bit more diffuse than actual city governance. So there's a huge opportunity in San Antonio when CPS is so big to make a huge change.
That's what's
been done elsewhere.
So frustrating about, the numbers you showed is obviously the ERCOT, the open market, is outperforming our city-owned utility when it comes to renewable energy, but we should be able to make those decisions for ourselves. But there's these hurdles, right? There's the hurdles, the structural hurdles of governmental arrangement, the contract arrangement with the city, the openness, the transparency of the utility, and that's what we need to decide, really, as a city, is that we're going to tolerate that, because I think the potential of owning our utility is huge, and it's so much better than being left to the captains of titans of industry, but we've just let it run away from us. I guess that's my comment. And then the other thing I want to, when you talk about renewable energy credits, in the same presentation that Paula Gold-Williams was making, I guess I should turn that around, was making about their ambition for the future, the mayor asked specifically about renewable energy credits. He said, and they were talking about crediting all the renewable energy we have, crediting that to the city for, and then buying renewable energy credits, so paying more money for these credits, so the city can then say, we're a green city.
because so all the city buildings will on paper be run by renewable energy. It doesn't really do anything, but maybe promote the idea of being green. So.
Yeah.
Kaiba talked to the Express News about that. Maybe Kaiba, you could tell them what you were telling them about that, or did you already?
It was essentially that.
Yeah.
Any other questions for Drew about CPS?
Yeah.
Or the new plan?
In like 7 minutes.
Yeah.
This is more for Kaiba because Drew said that she sat through the process by which Austin committed and with these like pretty good goals, it seems like. And then they went back and revisited them under the same mayor or a different mayor, different city council, like 2000, I guess it was 2010, looked like, and then 2014 again.
And then again in this 2016.
So they keep revisiting it as a mandate.
Every 2 years.
By whom? Is that the staff within the utility saying, hey, it's time, or is it from city council? I mean,
that's from city council that they established that there would be this 2 year planning process. Now, obviously, you'll notice it went from 2010 to 2014, so they kind of missed one in there. So it's not like everything's perfect in Austin, definitely not. And I think going forward, it's going to be on maybe more of a, I guess, 3 years, because we'll do the next one in 2019. And then the utility wanted to kind of shift it to every 5 years, but I think we're going to have it kind of every 2.5 so that it meshes up with our rate making. But essentially, yeah, that is part of the established process. It's called the Austin Energy Resource Generation and Climate Protection Plan. And it was, you know, kind of a big deal when they did the first one, and then it was decided that, well, we'll come back for all these updates because things change and you shouldn't be waiting 10 years to do another plan. Things change a lot faster than that.
Yes.
Thank you.
What would be the process for CPS to be changed from having the board, I guess, tell what to do to city council? What would that take? What would that process be? What would be the first thing to
take? Ultimately, it would be a change to the city charter with CPS. Russell Diva.
We tried this in the new fight. We made a big push and spent a lot of time and effort on that issue, and it came back to us. They said, went to the governing when it was originally formed, and it's the bond covenants. And they don't have, CPS's does not have good originally founding documents of their existence. It does not happen. So their only thing that governs them is the bond covenants of all the bonds they have issued, and their argument is if we change our structure, then we have to reissue all those bonds. How that true that is or not true it is, I don't really know, but that's their story. And that's been the story before, and whether if that's a monumental effort to fix or not, whether it's worth it that we choose that to be a battle. But let me tell you something, what everybody did in the last day or two to send to council people and everything, it was very effective. Paula Williams came off very defensive on what was happening. It was a totally different tone than what Greg and I heard the day before. So thank you, everybody. It was a good job, well done. It made a difference. That pressure from the community is just as effective as going after a legal battle to reissue all of their bonds. So we have avenues, and Councilman Courage asked some very good questions about citizens to be heard and to the board members of CPS Energy and to their Citizens Advisory Committee. He asked all of the right questions and he got very evasive answers. He asked Paula Gold Williams after the fact on those answers, which he is still not satisfied with, and he's going to be following up with him. So that also is going to open our communications. So they got the message.
We've got just 6 minutes. Anybody who haven't heard from yet, there's a number of folks in here.
that haven't been able to speak or ask a question?
I have a question. Maybe it's been asked before, but you know, we just, you know, solidified these steering committees and these working groups for the Climate Action and Adaptation Plan, and you know, CPS is making these statements and these plans for the future, and my concern is why wasn't the Climate Action and Adaptation Plan Committee, why weren't they involved in that? Because that seems like a huge part of our carbon footprint is coming from our the use of our utility, and so why are we not, if we're trying to address climate action, why was our working groups, why did this decision come before the plan was in place?
Who wants that? I think that's a great question. I think it's for CPS, and I think they don't have a good answer. There's no reason they shouldn't be working with the community in this way.
I asked that question and got evasive answers. But their bottom line is that this is a flexible plan that we will go forward and work with the community in the CAP process, that we are committed to the CAP process, and I think they got bruised today, and I think it's because of what Greg and Kaiba on sending that message out to the council people made that difference. Evasive answer, but it is, she stressed over and over again, this plan is not locked in stone. This is what we have to go through for. We talked about what's it going to take for the community to do to be able to shut down. Todd Horstman did not even know, a VP in charge of working with the demand management sectors and all this stuff, he didn't even know that the board meeting was going to happen. A key person involved was in Arizona and didn't find about it till after the fact. So the it wasn't just external people that were pissed off, it was internal people that felt like they were silent.
Well, sustainability
so
office
why,
too.
Yeah, Doug didn't know about it until we did 1 hour before.
No.
He raced over there 1 hour before, and he also expressed to directly to Paula how irritated he was.
Yeah. I
so.
Want to just time check. It's 3 minutes. Jessica, I want to.
Sure. Just a quick question.
Yeah. No, I want to hear from you. We haven't heard from you yet. And Drew has to get a cab or a ride from someone or something to get up to the bus station.
I'll just walk.
Oh, he's just gonna walk. but then at 4:00 we've got time to kind of like work together, strategize, and all that. So.
Just really quick, so who finally approves this plan? Is it the board, the CPS board, and do they need approval from City Council? Just
board,
CPS board.
Board, CPS board, they do not need approval from City Council. The mayor is on the board. How the mayor feels about his own power on the board, I think that maybe we've seen some of
with caveat. The caveat is the only thing City Council by ordinance has to do by the governance is rate increases. All it, if they ever go for a rate increase or time of day change,
yeah,
or any kind of their rate structures, then it's City Council's decision.
They can go up or down.
And I'd also give a direct response to Liz from her question earlier of why was the CAP process not considered in this plan. Comes down to accountability. CPS doesn't have any formal accountability to the CAP process or plan, at least as things stand right now. Of course, there's informal and formal accountability. We showed some informal holding them accountable in the past few days, making them be defensive. But where does the formal accountability come in?
Yeah.
It's not, it doesn't exist.
The contracts
anymore
with UTSA.
Yeah.
Question, I guess, maybe quick. Who would be in charge of changing the city charter with CPS? Would that be City Council? Who would initiate that?
Has to go to vote.
We could take, do a referendum.
It'd still be to the bondholders. It's the bondholders would have to be agreed to renegotiate their bonds.
Who are they?
They're spread all across the nation.
Yeah. Drew, do you
want to make a decision?
That's, well, they would have to agree to sell to reissue bonds for long term. Corporate bonds, utility bonds.
I'm going to put it over on Drew so you can kind of close us out with some observations on our conversation.
conversation or
yeah, so,
takeaways?
Just again, I want to be a resource for everybody. I was obviously able to get all the information that I had in the slides today, and I have sources for all the information in them. I'll send out those slides. I encourage everyone to make this presentation yourselves if you want to. I mean, it's all there, and I want to be a resource for everybody. So while I don't have, of course, the experiential knowledge of the city, I'm glad that I could provide some numbers and comparisons to let you know how weird things are
yeah.
in this city.
Keeps
so, yeah.
telling me all weird. All right, thank you very much, Drew.
Thanks.
I appreciate it.